I'm going to keep on telling stories, Old Testament stories this week. And I'll pick it up again in August, I think, when I'm back. But this story this week, I want to start. Well, we got any Downton Abbey fans here?
A few of us, yes, you know.
And you know that story starts off with this wealthy man with three daughters. Trouble, you know. What's a wealthy man to do with three daughters? The eldest daughter cannot inherit the estate. And so begins the unwinding story of who's going to inherit, who will marry Mary, whatever will be done. That was just 100 years ago, when in the world it was very structured on who could inherit what. In the Old Testament times, it was really, really structured on who could inherit what. They all knew who could inherit, and they all knew what their responsibility was to the surviving people. It was all clearly written out. But then God comes along, and God does an extraordinary thing. He actually does this several times in Scripture. Here comes God. And when God comes in, you can forget all your organizing institutional structures, because God can do far more than we can ever ask or imagine. Because God's ways are not our ways. He says to them so clearly, my ways are beyond your ways. My ways are beyond your ways. Last week we had that, didn't we, in the story of those, the promise, descendants more than all the stars in the sky I will give you. And then he gives three barren women in order to fulfill that promise. Only man couldn't do it, woman couldn't do it. Only by the hand, by the grace of God could it be done. My ways are beyond your ways. I want to tell you the story of Jacob and Esau this morning. And it keeps us in that same place of being open to and discovering and living with a God who can do far more than we can ever ask or imagine. A God who will blow apart the expectations that we place upon him. We call him him. So one day, Rebecca found out she was pregnant. Oh, she was happy. This felt so good. At long last, 20 years they had waited. 20 years they had waited for a child, and finally she's pregnant. But oh, it's not a pregnancy that goes well at all. And some of us women can speak to it. It can be hard to bear a child. And she could feel this energy inside her. It's like there was a war zone inside her. Because this is the story of two fighting boys. Two fighting men. They were different, even in the womb. When they finally arrived in the world, one of them arrived all hairy and grisly and came out first, and the other one had his hand grasping the heel and getting pulled out by the elder, and he came out smooth and shining and just beautiful. They grew up differently too. Great Uncle Esau, he grew up as an outdoorsman, a rugged man, rough and tough, loved to learn to shoot, loved to learn to hunt, loved to be in the outdoors, loved to bring food back to the people. He was aggressive and strong. I imagine he was a bit of an extrovert. He went and he hung out in the other tribes all around. He hung out so much there, he found himself a wife from the Hittites. And he brought this strange woman back into the family camp. There was a wildness, an aggressiveness, an outgoingness to Esau. But Jacob grew up differently. Smooth skin, described as a gentleman, probably a reflective man, more introvertish. Like to stay at home, like to be among the tents, like to cook, like to be bound there. Two very different men. Now we're reminded that Isaac had a favoring of Esau, the wild one. And Rebekah had a favoring of Jacob, the tender one. Now you need to know that in that culture, there were two things that were very, very, very special to have. One was a birthright, and the other was a blessing. And guess who got those? Firstborn son got both the birthright and the blessing. The birthright was a double portion of the inheritance. He got twice what anybody else would get. Abraham had been a wealthy man. Isaac was a wealthy man, inheriting from Abraham and prospering as well. And he was looking forward to giving this wealth to his son. But then one day, something happened that upset all of Isaac's plans. Because sometimes life doesn't go the way we think it should go or would go. One day, his wild, outrageous, outdoorsy son came home famished, empty. All he could think about was his own stomach and how empty he was. And he was a free living off the earth kind of guy. He didn't really look to have a whole lot of stuff. He was more an in the moment, I see that animal, I'm gonna get it and bring it home kind of man. And he came home famished, he hadn't caught anything. And he said to his brother tending the pot, give me some of that. But his brother said to him, yeah, give me your birthright though. And he was so blind, he was so deaf, he was so dumb, he had such scorn working through him and such selfishness driving, he said, deal done. I'll take that pot of stew and you can have whatever the old man's gonna give me. What a day that was. But the story doesn't even end there, because there was something else he had coming to him that was ever so special, and it's called a blessing. And it's hard for us to get around our understanding of it because we don't know what it means to receive a blessing like they did in the Old Testament times. It's not just like, I bless you, Joan, as you're heading off on your summer vacation. It's not like that. A father gives a blessing to his son. He's giving the core of his being to his son. He's giving him something that is legally, although it's just in words, it's not written, it's legally binding as he passes it from one to the other. It's the core of his being, the essence of who he is, the goodness of what he longs for, what he knows and longs for his son. And for Isaac to give a blessing, he's giving the blessing that he received from his father, Abraham. And that's the blessing of the descendants, as many as the stars in the sky, a land that will be your own, and that through you, all people on the earth will be blessed. That's the blessing he's got. So one day, Isaac's beginning to feel the end coming near. He's getting old and his eyesight is failing. And he says, I want to give you the blessing now while I'm aware. I want to give you this, Esau. Go get me something good to eat and I will bless you this day. And what happens is, Rebekah hears, she says no way because she favors Jacob. And she dresses Jacob up in Esau's clothing and puts some rough skin on his arm so that he'll smell like Esau. Isaac can't see, but he can still smell. And he gives him the food. She gives him the food that Esau would give him. He can't see, but he can taste and he can smell. And so Jacob goes into Isaac's tent and says, here I am. Isaac's a little wary of what's going on here, what's happening. Doesn't quite sound like Esau, but smells like Esau, tastes like Esau. And what do you know? He says, okay, I will give you the blessing. And so he lays upon Jacob the blessing that was due to the firstborn. Oh, my goodness. When Esau finds out, like, he was so upset. He was raging mad. He was so angry, and he's a tough man. He's going to go and hurt his younger brother. Just imagine what their family dinner table must have been like that night. You know, we got two parents playing favorites. We got two men contending with each other. We got a foreign wife sitting around the table who's not one of them and isn't really welcomed by the parents. Oh, my goodness. Tension around a family dinner table? Yeah. Yeah. Story goes on, but I'm going to stop it there for now. Why? Why do you think that story was held by Israel as a very important family story? Jesus would have gone to Mary and tell me the story about, you know, great-grandfather Jacob and great-uncle Esau and how they fought all the time. Tell me the story, Mom. It was a story that he knew. Why would Israel have kept a story that was about favoritism, that was about selfishness, that was about scorn, that was about deception? Why would they treasure a story like that? Does your family treasure your unsavory stories? You know, in my family, we didn't. They only came out occasionally. What? That happened? I had never heard that. They didn't. The family stories that we tell are more fun, more playful, more happy stories. We don't tell so much the dark stories. But Israel savored this story. Favoritism, scorn, selfishness, deceit. If you weren't here last week, you got a handout on why we read the Old Testament. And this was the book I was suggesting that you get and read. One of the reasons we read the Old Testament is that the New Testament talks about it. And the New Testament talks about this story of Jacob and Esau. Paul in Romans uses it as a real teaching point. So when you're reading the New Testament, if you don't understand and comprehend what's going on in this story, that whole bit will just zing right over your head and not make any sense. So one good reason we read Old Testament is to understand New Testament. And the other piece is how we read the Old Testament, and I offered you this book of Fee and Stewart for how to read. And one of the important pieces is there, what kind of literature you're reading, poetry, narrative, that sort of stuff, but also knowing the culture, knowing what's going on, understanding what a birthright is, understanding what a blessing is, helps inform your reading of that story as well. The other piece is that there's three levels of story, which was what Sharon was talking about there. In any of the narratives of the Old Testament, you can read it from an individual level, the different characters. You can read it from the level of the story of Israel, the nation of Israel forming, and you can read it from the story of God's narrative of who is God anyway, and what we can learn about him there. We could go back to that story, and we could pick apart like Isaac prayed for 20 years. I mean, we could do prayer and the importance of persisting in our prayer, praying for a long time for something. We could go to Rebecca, who prayed and got what she wanted and found it so, so difficult. We could discover and explore what it's like to have things that are so challenging and so difficult for you in your life. We could just look at Jacob and Esau and the morality of it, their selfishness. And we could talk about the kind of selfish people and how we deal with them, or maybe our own inner selfishness. Like, we could take those stories and go that individual line, but I'm not going to go there. I'm not going to go down any of those rabbit trails. We could take it and do the nation of Israel story, which was the first bit that Sharon mentioned that's so important. Do you know Jacob's other name? He has the name Israel. He gets given that name later on in the stories. And he's the one that has, how many sons does Jacob have? 12. And what else do we know about Israel and 12? There are the... They come from this fellow Jacob. He's really, really, really important in the forming of their story. The 12 tribes of Israel come out of this scheming, manipulating, deceitful man. This is Jesus' family tree. It's so important that we know it. And what I want to focus in on there is the most amazing thing that God does in the midst of it all. I gotta say, I really like this piece. Partly because I'm a woman, I think. Like, how many firstborn sons do we have in the room? Okay, so we've got a half a dozen, six or eight of you. And how many of the rest of us are not firstborn sons? Okay. God gives the promise. He gives the promise to the younger son. He totally breaks all the rules, all the institutional rules that are there, all the hierarchy that is set up, all the family plans that are set up. He totally breaks them all aside. And he said, I will give my blessing to the younger son. And I got to say, as a woman and as not a firstborn son, there is some hope there, you know. There's something that I'm dealing with a God who is different. I have a God that is a God of potentiality, a God of possibility, a God that invites me to go beyond the restrictive walls that might be there, a God who is able, one more time, showing us a God who is able to do far more than we can ever ask or imagine. He gave a promise of all those descendants, plunk three barren women, and out of that come all of the descendants, because it's God's work in God's way. Because God can do far more than we can ask or imagine, because God's ways are beyond our ways. The other piece of it is, though, not only does he give the blessing to the younger son, he does this a few other times in Scripture as well. David's another great story of God going outside the box and making the lineage through the younger son. The other piece, too, is very sobering, I think, for us all. He gives the blessing to Jacob while he was in the womb. Before Jacob ever came into the world, before Jacob ever did anything good or nasty, he held God's blessing. Now that's just to blow aside any sense that what we do around here is that we earn God's blessing upon us, earn our place. That whole sense of meritocracy is to go out. The whole sense of perfectionism, the whole sense of accomplishments, of competencies, of earning God's favor, is to go out. God's blessing was upon Jacob in the womb. It seems random, it seems arbitrary, there's no explanation given, but the blessing is upon Jacob. And so we are to know so clearly that it's not about us. It is about God. It's about God's Spirit moving through us and in this world. And that God can and will and does take and work in all sorts of circumstances in life. God doesn't run away from darkness, doesn't run. He's not like a cockroach that takes off, you know. God is present in the midst of selfishness, in the midst of favoritism, in the midst of scorn and deception. God is still present, and God is still working out his purposes, his will, in his way. It's really quite a stunning thing that goes against most of our human grain, you know? We want things organized in an expected way. We want to be able to behave ourselves and get rewarded for our good behavior. We want to work hard and get rewarded for our good work that we have done. That's kind of a human programming we have. And God is just coming in and saying, you know what? Be humble before me. I am your creator. I am the one who has formed you and shaped you. Out of all these stories, if we might know God's presence, that you were known in the womb. When you were curled up in your mom's womb, you were known by God. God was present at your birth. God has heard each prayer that has come out of your heart. God has known each ache and each pain that has been part of your life. God is always present, everywhere, even in the darkness that we can head into, even in the darkness that's in this world, God is present. And God can and does use and work goodness through human selfishness and insensitivity. God is God. Love is the universal law that runs the universe, and love will win. Because love triumphed on the cross, love is stronger. So, I would just leave you to ponder. Do you put expectations around God? Do you have rules that God needs to live by? There'll probably be unconscious, you might not even be aware of it. But are you putting some sort of limits and restrictions upon God, saying you can only function in this way? Are you willing to go beyond what you've known in the past? Are you willing to believe in the God of the Old Testament that can take three barren women and make a nation? That can take a scornful, deceitful, conniving family and through them bless the whole entire world and trust that God in your life? Let's pray together. Heavenly Father, you are more vast than the stars in the sky. You are bigger than I can ever comprehend. And I love that you work into our lives, that you're present within us, that you have known us in our mother's womb, and that you know us today, right here, on a rainy Sunday. You know where we are and what's going on in our lives. Help us, Lord, to be fertile soil, to open ourselves to you, trusting you to work goodness in our lives. Help us to go beyond whatever we can ask or imagine, and to believe in your bigness, to believe in your bigness, to know your love deep in our lives. In Jesus' name I pray.